Welcome to another episode of Pound for Pound Boxing Report. I'm your host, Michael. Joining me this evening, Daniel Carpio, the Inscriber, Jacob Rivera joining us. What's going on, fellas?
How's it going?
I'm doing, all things considering, normally, I will go through the rundown of where you can find the show and whatnot, but tonight I'm beginning the show on a really, really somber note. A couple of shows back, we ended the show talking about Fife Dog from A Tribe Called Quest, who passed away at the time at the early age of 45. Well, as everybody know, or at least unless you've been hiding under a rock, news broke today that the one and only Prince passed away at his home in Paisley Park earlier today at age 57. I was gutted. I've been gutted all day, all evening long. I was really unsure whether I would even do the show tonight, but I just said, let's just go ahead and get it out the way. But I want to begin the show talking about Prince for a bit, your memories of him, the man, and his music especially. And I'll just open up the floor to you, either Daniel, Jacob, whoever wants to chime in. Your thoughts on the passing of Prince, where were you when you first heard it, your memories of the music, et cetera, et cetera. Just overall, the passing of Prince, how did it hit you?
Yeah. I mean, I heard it early this morning, and I was shocked because typically, or it seems nowadays, you know, you hear at least a little bit, like maybe someone's sick, or you know, if there was an accident, you know, obviously that stuff happens. But I hadn't heard anything about him being even, you know, close at the age that he is. You know, 57. It's young, and he looked like from what I've seen of him recent, you know, he looked like he was in good shape. You know, he had done some concerts, and I know he played at the Forum a few years back here, and I had a couple friends that went to that concert, and they said it was just awesome. He brought up a bunch of special guests and whatnot, but he's definitely a big showman. One of the things I respected about Prince was that not only was his music good, he writes his lyrics, but he plays a plethora of instruments, which, you know, he's like what I would define as a real musician. And I know this is going to sound maybe a little controversial, but, you know, Michael Jackson, as much as I like him and as much of a good artist that he is, a great artist that he was, and his songs, I actually was a bigger Prince fan than a Michael Jackson fan. And I know they were compared a lot. But to me, his music was, it struck a chord in me a little bit more than Jackson, you know. So, but again, I mean, this is life, and, you know, as we get older, you know, the people that we knew from when we were kids to, you know, as we're growing up, will, you know, go on and pass on. So, you know, it's a sad day, but again, like I said, with the Fife Dog thing is that, you know, they left a legacy of music, and, you know, play their music not just for, you know, the 2 weeks after they're dead, but, you know, pop it in, you know, every week for, you know, until the end of time, and introduce it to younger people that haven't heard it before, or, you know, because of the generation gaps, because good music and great artists will stand the test of time.
Daniel?
I found out, unfortunately, actually on my lunch break from work. Because I said, sit down, I checked my phone, I checked Twitter. First it was the news that somebody died at his estate. And then TMC came out with the news that Prince passed on, and this is one of the times I really wish TMZ was wrong. Because unfortunately, when it comes to stuff like this, they're usually right. And unfortunately, they were. There's so much you can say about Prince. So much. I think for a lot of people that are at my age, or at very least I think within months of my age, we probably would not be here if not for Purple Rain. Let's be blunt. We would not be here without Purple Rain. And that's on top of the one thing. Like, music-wise, like I said, Jacob has said it controversial. Like, it was virtually a race between him and Michael Jackson of who was the better overall artist. And I'm not going to get into that because I like to live. But with Prince, the versatility that he brought because of the way he played the instruments, and just his overall persona, gave a vibe to a lot of the people that it was really okay for you to be you. And that's very, very important in communities that are mainly, like I said, black and brown, because yeah, you could have David Bowie, but unfortunately, yeah, if David Bowie, like, somebody passed away, like, this has been a terrible year for celebrity deaths. But Prince was the guy that I think allowed a lot of black and brown kids to, I think somebody put on Twitter, they allowed him to be weird. Because he himself, you consider weird, but he was really, really nice weird. But what I think I liked most about Prince was how he stood up to the record industry.
Yeah.
And fought for his rights, because if people don't know, he died owning all of his masters. In the record business, that is unheard of. Usually, like, especially, like, I think your first couple albums, if you're a successful artist, somebody else owns your masters. And you had to fight and claw your way to possibly get them back. Like, speaking of Michael Jackson, that's one of the reasons why Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney didn't get along for a while, because Michael Jackson bought the rights to Beatles music and licensed it for commercials against the wishes of, like, a Paul McCartney and the rest of the Beatles. Prince didn't allow that to happen to his music. And the way he did it was just insane. I think everybody remembers the phase when he actually, where he dropped the name Prince and just went by the artist. It was his way of saying, I'm not going to bow down to the pressure. I'm gonna fight for what's mine, and he did. I feel really bad, like I said, when it comes to this situation. I especially feel really, really bad for the various people, lives he's touched, whether it's through music or just his overall demeanor. Because I do know one thing, that Prince was a pretty, pretty big basketball fan. And I think he would have been happy with some of the news, like yesterday with the Minnesota Timberwolves. And people were looking forward to it. I've seen people in Minnesota talking about it's going to be nice to see Prince courtside again. And man, there's so much to get into when it comes to Prince. The closest thing I think the Latino community has is somebody like Prince, where an artist pretty much allowed themselves to be different from the crowd was probably, I don't know if Jacob remembers this, but Gloria Trevi. Regular pop singer that fit more actually on the lines of Cyndi Lauper than Prince, but if you consider the range of what Latin music was in the 70s and 80s, she was the closest thing to Prince when it comes to that. And I'm going to leave it at that, and hopefully Gil will come back, because I just saw her pop in and pop out.
Oh, wow. Your mic is sounding a little bit choppy, Daniel. I'm just letting you know right now. Yeah, she says she can't hear anything for some reason. So if you're around, Gil, let me just reach out to her. She may have to reboot her system, her computer.
How, How do I sound now?
You still sound a little bit choppy. You may have to reboot yourself right quick. You were sounding like choppy as I was a few weeks back.
All right, let me be right back then.
Okay. I was coming home. Had the day off today. I was coming home from the vitamin store, and I was had to make a quick stop at Kmart. Coming back from there, and news broke on the radios confirming the passing of Prince. What? I'm like, what? I'm like, no. threw my hands up in the air while in the car. I could have caused an accident, to be honest with you. And I've been pretty devastated and pretty gutted all day, all evening long. I was contemplating not even doing the show this evening. That's how hurt I've been. As a musician, there are a few musical geniuses out today. He's one of them. Outside of Stevie Wonder, maybe the one true musical genius we really have left. When people talk about they are a self-contained unit, excuse me. Prince is that. The multiple instruments he played, which I've heard anywhere from 20 to 25 instruments he could play. He could produce, he could arrange, he could mix, he was a beat maker, he could engineer, he could perform, he could sing. In short, the brother could do it all. And arguably the greatest singer over the last, arguably the greatest artist, excuse me, over the last 30, 35 years. Sign of the Times in 87, 10 years ahead of his time. Hell, he's had really nothing to prove since 87 when he dropped Sign of the Times. I've been putting out stuff all day on, if you follow me on social media, including some vinyl prints that I got. It's not just what he did behind the mic and in the studio and on stage. Daniel said, and I hope you can get him back, it's the battles he fought behind the scenes in the boardrooms, the epic battle with Warner Brothers, which at the end of the day he won, the brother won, and it's also his activism and advocacy away from the music realm. The stuff that he did, we did not know about, or he kept on low key. The fact that he was a supporter of Black Lives Matter, the fact that he did a free benefit concert in the aftermath of the senseless killing of Freddie Gray. He was not just an artist, he was a humanitarian, and the heart is heavy this evening as I do this show. I see Gail Falkenthal has joined us from Community Digital News. We're talking Prince here to begin the show, kind of a weird beginning to the show, but again, given who he was, I would not do a show without saying something in response to him, this tragic passing. You talked about Gail on social media, your memories of Prince, and I will give you the opportunity to express them now right here.
Hey, yeah, good evening, everybody. Well, we couldn't help but talk about this, you know? I mean, boxing is life to a lot of us here, and so is music. And in their different ways, athletes and musicians and singers are both artists, and the good ones give it all, every single time. And that is certainly something you can say about the best fighters, and it's something you can say about Prince. And I distinctly remember hearing him for the first time, and for me it was the Controversy album in 1981. And I gotta tell you, it blew my head off. It blew my little suburban head off. It was fantastic. I worked in radio at the time. I worked in at a college radio station. And that vinyl came with a poster. And I mentioned it on social media, but I didn't see, Michael, whether or not you knew what the poster I was talking about. It was a pinup shot of Prince in a shower wearing, you know, some barely concealing sort of leather, gender-bending dominatrix sort of costuming. And, you know, being the rowdy college kids we were, we put that poster on the ceiling above the door to the air studio. So you had to be blessed and walk under Prince in the shower into the studio before you could go in and do your show on the air. And then a group of us went to see him at the San Diego Sports Arena, perhaps one of the worst places in America to see a concert, because it was just a big darn echoey hole in the wall at that time. We went to see him on that tour, and it was mind-blowing. And like everyone who's ever crossed that man's path, loved and admired him ever since. Incredibly talented. And what I also like a lot about him is the fact that he decided to make his headquarters where he grew up. He stayed in Minnesota all his life. I mean, he certainly traveled the world, but home was always home, and that says a lot about the man that he chose to stay there when I'm sure there were a lot of other things luring him elsewhere. And man, it's been a rough, rough year in music, hasn't it, Michael? Just rough.
I mean, oh my God. The irony here. Prince passes a little over 2 months after Vanity died.
Right. Damn, I didn't even think about that.
That's right.
I talk Fife Dawg. I mean, two of the music pioneers, Prince, Maurice White, the Earth, Wind, and Fire, passing back to back, basically.
Yep. Maurice White, Fife Dawg, David Bowie, Lemmy from Motorhead, Prince. I mean, all in their own genres, geniuses.
Yeah, absolutely.
The other thing about Prince's music, which is really striking me because, you know, we're all bringing out the catalogs back today, is a lot of music of that era and after that, you hear the song and you enjoy it. But you hear the song and you also say in your head, 1990, you know? I mean, the songs sometimes date themselves. If you hear a song of Prince's, if you didn't know what year it came out, it still sounds current in every possible way. That is very difficult to achieve.
And you mentioned the poster you had. That was the thing about this dude. That's what made him so cold. I mean, what people first know him for, the song Controversy. Am I black or white? Am I straight or gay? Controversy.
And we're still talking about that. We're still talking about that.
And people will talk about that, and he may be this, and let's just be real. Yeah, it was a little bit hard being a Prince fan when he was running. He was out on the stage with the assless jeans.
Maybe for you.
while all this was happening, dude was pulling the baddest women.
That's right.
And
Michael, he was a tiny little dude.
Oh yeah, he was pretty much a teacup, you know, dude. He was
platform shoes side. I could probably look him in the eye. I mean, damn.
he was pretty much a teacup human, but I mean, listen. Bria Valente from Sheila E. to Apollonia, the underground myth that he basically stole Vanity from Rick James.
Oh man, Vanity too. Vanity's gone too, man.
The list it's not that controversial to say, Jacob, that you had Prince better than you thought Prince was better than Michael Jackson, because I know a lot of folks believe that. the consistency of Prince. The 90s wasn't great for him, but you can disregard that. But yeah, he was that dude. Let me find it while y'all continue to talk. There was a post that a friend of mine shared, and y'all continue, you can talk on right quick. I'm going to find a post that basically describes Prince from T, sum him up best. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, again, the whole comment, the Michael Jackson-Prince comparison, again, it's just my preference. I'm not any expert, and it really just goes down to that. It just, his music to me, as far as what I listen to more often, and his songs just kind of, you know, to me were spoke to me in a different way than Michael Jackson's did. Both great artists, you know, both, you know, define that eras, their eras. But again, it's just my personal preference.
Nobody blames that personal preference, because it's something that's probably still being battled to this day. It is literally, like, if you want to look at pop music, it's probably like Hatfields and McCoys. Prince fans versus Michael fans. Because none of them will back down.
And Prince has got a Dave Chappelle skit, too, so that's pretty cool.
I can't believe we need to be ranking these guys. I mean, really? Do we really need to be doing that? Can't they exist on the same plane? I think no, that ranking them is ridiculous. Ridiculous.
I wasn't ranking them. I was just saying my preference.
No. I mean, yeah. But you know what? I know me, you know, and the way I approach music is strictly as a fan, is one day I have a preference for this artist, and tomorrow I'm in a different mood, and I have a preference for another artist.
Okay, here it is. Whoever this is, Dallas Cole on Twitter, she posted this. I want y'all to really understand something. Prince was prettier than Beyonce, cockier than Kanye, bald like MJ, constructing heels like Naomi Campbell, dressed like Anna Wintour, played all the instruments, wrote all the songs, fucked all the bitches, threw more shade than a Savannah oak tree with Spanish moth with Idris Elba swag and James Earl Jones voice. Do you motherfuckers understand that everything and absolute greatness that left us, there would never be another? The sky is pouring purple rain on all of us today. R.I.P. Prince. That says it all. That says brilliant. It all right there.
Brilliant. Boom. Brilliant. Drop the mic right now.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. But I just realized the sad part of it. I just realized this is the truly sad part of it, and I think Jacob mentioned it. There's going to be a lot of young folks, a lot of youngins, that are only going to remember Prince because of that Chappelle Show skit.
Wow, do we really think that? Maybe. Well, a lot of them, honestly, don't remember his strongest parts of his catalog at all.
Yeah, that's okay, you're right. But ultimately, that is on us, older folks, to remind younger folks who either don't know, don't care, that those artists that you listen to now that y'all think hot, they got something from him. They got something from him, no doubt. So that's a lot of that is on us.
Yeah. No, and I agree with you, Michael. Like, I mean, I have a young son, young daughter, and one of the things that I like to do on the weekend is I like to fill the house with music. Like, you know, if we're in the room playing or whatever, I almost always turn on the radio or turn on my iPod or something like that, and you know, listen to artists like Prince and just classic artists that I think that the younger generation aren't going to get exposed to unless somebody does it, because you're not going to, you know, unless you're listening to certain, you know, oldie stations and whatnot, or you, like, again, you're glued to a catalog somehow. All the artists that are around now, they definitely were influenced by someone like Prince. But I try to do that job of, you know, exposing my son and daughter to all different types of these music and these artists, and then, You know, and you can see the impact. I mean, they'll remember the words of the song, and, you know, he's 5 years old, and I mean, Purple Rain is one of his favorite songs because purple is his favorite color.
So he
has that connection. And, you know, I'm actually have been quizzing him, like, you know, I'll say, like, oh, you know, someone comes on, yeah, who's this? And he's starting to get it right, you know, more often than not, and learning the lyrics. And so, again, to your point, it's our job to make sure that, you know, these artists, as they pass, that they live on forever within their music and the work that they put so much into.
Yep, definitely, yeah. Definitely. Let's see, I think people will put it to you this way for the hip hop generation. That really, like I said, that really thinks like the roots are old school, because that's unfortunately where that point.
Right.
We're at that point. Without Prince, the roots don't exist. Without Prince, Living Color really wouldn't exist. Or at least it wouldn't have a black frontman.
Yeah. And they would tell you that, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah. We're going to get to the boxing, but, you know, as I said before, I could not, I will not, on this episode, on this day, have this show without having some mention of the passing of one Prince Rogers Nelson, one of the greatest, if not the greatest, contemporary artists out here who passed earlier today. Now let's get to the boxing, recap what went down this weekend, highlighted for me by Errol Spence fighting Chris Algieri, kind of an elimination bout. Spence took apart Algieri. There's no other way to put it. Took apart Algieri, who a lot of folks thought, that he was going to give Spence a really, really tough fight. And I know some folks who came on my show predicting Algieri would beat Errol Spence. It was a no contest. Decent first round for Algieri, but from round two on, Spence dominated. Put him down, knocked him down three times, once in the fourth, twice more in the fifth, made it look easy. He found distance with the left hand. He showed himself to be the far stronger guy physically and technically, put that all together. Algieri was no match, and look, Errol Spence, he was a rising contender. I've been on him for a while, me and the homie from the YTBC, Mr. Nani Turner, we've been on this dude for a while. He showed and proved that this dude is ready. He's ready for any welterweight out there. Doesn't matter who. I'll start with you, Gail. Were you as impressed as I was at the way Spence performed Saturday night?
Incredibly impressed. There should be no one left in boxing who has any question about whether Errol Spence has the goods. Errol Spence has the goods. You know, let's think about Chris Algieri's last few fights. Forget the fact whether he won or lost. He made it farther with all of his higher-ranked opponents than Spence than he did with Spence. He made a good accounting of himself, even in the losses. You know, there were a lot of people who thought those were closer fights, particularly with Amir Khan, than the scorecards revealed. And then he gets in with Spence, and you think, okay, he's probably going to lose, but he'll give a good accounting of himself. And then he just gets flattened. You know, that man was, you know, being dropped over and over and over. You know, you were praying someone would show that man mercy and this thing would be done, and it was. Spence has now crossed the bar up to, I don't think he's ready for the top echelon of competition, but he has definitely left the tune-ups, the middle range guys and the pretenders behind. No more of that. Now it's time for him to face some real challenging names and show what he can do. He's earned it after that fight. Very impressive performance. Good for him.
I'll go to you, Jacob, then you can follow up, Daniel. I believe both of y'all picked Spence to win last week. But did any of you guys expect this kind of domination?
I knew Algieri was a tough kid. I actually did pick Spence to, I think it was like 7th round KO. I thought he was going to stop him. Algieri was really never in the fight. I think Spence wanted to make a statement, and that's what I was feeling was going to happen, and he did just that, you know. And the statement was, you know, do something that all these other great fighters couldn't previously. He looked really good. Algieri's a tough kid. Probably, I don't know, maybe 147 isn't the best weight for him. He's pretty much a gatekeeper now. I give my hats off to Algieri for taking the fight and, you know, never backing down from a challenge. He made some pretty good coins. But now, you know, with Spence, you know, moving up, he does a lot of great things. You know, he invests in the body. He's got a really good jab. He's got good power too. And he's patient. Which is rare for a young guy. I know he's not number one now. I know some news came out about it. I was a little kind of pissed about this. But there is no number one. Number one's vacant for IBF. He's number two. You know, Brooks talking about potentially fighting him, but also Danny Garcia and other people. So I hope that fight happens soon. I think that's a 50-50 fight. You know, the only knock I can give on Spence, the critique is that he does kind of, he can get wild and he does leave himself open for counters sometimes. And with a fighter like Brooke, who's very technically sound, I think that could be very interesting. We haven't really seen Spence take a solid shot or have to go through adversity, by being hurt or being shook up a little bit. So I'm interested to see how that goes down. But, hats off to Spence. He came in, did his job, and, looked damn impressive.
Daniel?
Oh, man. I'm going to reiterate the thoughts that I had last week. Like I said, I thought Spence was going to win, but I was still worried that if Algieri gave more than enough proof that it could unravel really quick. I'm glad I was proven wrong. Spence has arrived, in a sense, because as unfair as I think Francis on our show on Monday pointed out, as unfair as it is, you can say now that Errol Spence did what Ruslan Provodnikov, Amir Khan, and most importantly, Manny Pacquiao couldn't do. And that's take out Chris Algieri. And he did it with an emphatic punch. Like, when he, right at that last knockdown, if you look at it, when he saw that opening, he cocked back that hand and threw it with a lot of conviction. Because he knew, said, I'm just going to finish you now. And that's what he did. He showed to be really good. He showed that he could take away a lot of good tools from a technical fighter like Algieri. But as Jacob pointed out, the issue, though, is he's never really taken a shot from somebody that has a lot of power. And ideally, you want it to be Kell Brook right now. Because, yeah, he's the highest ranked person for the IBF right now, but the IBF just now ordered a title unification fight between Spence and Konstantin Ponomarev, like their next ranked guy, to get the number one contender spot. There's not much you can say when it comes to Spence that doesn't leave you with the words impressive when it comes to victories like this. He did more than what he was supposed to do, and he's definitely past prospect phase. And I'll go farther along than I think some people here. He's ready he's ready for the big show. So you can bring on Kell Brook, you can bring on Danny Garcia, you can bring on Jesse Vargas. He's ready for any of them.
He fights Jesse Vargas. He beats him, possibly stops him. He fights Danny Garcia. He beats him. I think in a fight with Bradley, he has a damn good chance of beating him. In a fight with Thurman, he has a damn good chance of beating him. The way he looks Saturday night, he could compete with Pacquiao. No doubt about it in my mind. Brook is the fight I want to see. Unfortunately, it's not going to happen next. And the reason I say Brook is because I think from a physical and a style matchup, that's the best fight. I will go so far as to say if Kell Brook, Errol Spence Jr. is one of the top five bouts in boxing and the best bout that could be made right now in the welterweight division.
Without a doubt.
Yep. Absolutely. But you know who you're going to see. He's going to fight the winner of Ortiz Berto too. I'm telling you right now.
Who is Spence?
Yeah. I would bet my next paycheck on it. He will fight the winner of Ortiz Berto too. Yep. And you know what? That's okay. That's a step up. Those are names. Those names will help get him in front of another audience. It's makeable. It's extremely makeable for PBC. It's affordable. It's a great summer fight. I say fine. It's not the ultimate goal we want, but that won't chap my hide if I see that next. And you know, we'll see the outcome of that fight. They, of course, are scheduled next Saturday, a week from this Saturday.
Okay, so. I still want to make my case for Brook Spence, because I believe that fight again is just so doggone good. Here's the thing. Brook is the only guy I see right now at 147 who has the size and the strength to physically compete with Spence, who's both are big guys in the division. And plus, Brook is very skilled. He's more disciplined than Thurman. He does more, in my opinion, than a Garcia. I'm not even going to throw Jesse Vargas in this discussion. I don't want to be dismissive of the guy, but I just don't think he's in either of these guys' league right now. The style of both Brook and Spence are conducive for a good fight, given the fact that neither guy moves much. The only concern I would have with Brook is how would he handle the inside game of Spence. Conversely, Spence has never fought anybody with the outright physical strength that Kell Brook has. I mean, we've seen Kell Brook. The cat looks like he could fight at junior middleweight right now. And you see how we all know how much he blows up in between fights. We've seen him, he can pack on pounds easily, so that tells me he has some issues. He probably has some issues making 147, but again, style dream for me. I look at Spence. I've said this on other channels on the YTBC that to me he's a left-handed Mike McCallum. You mentioned the patience, you mentioned the body work, the focus on the body, Jacob, and the jab. That's everything McCallum used to do. He just does it from a left-handed stance. And that he's just an inch or two shorter than McCallum. But you watch McCallum, fights of him in the 80s and early 90s, and you watch Spence now, they're clones of each other in terms of how they fight, or how they approach the game. Conversely, Brook, he's a guy who really has no visible weakness. Maybe not the best inside fighter, but he can get away with it because he's so strong. he can hold and ward and push guys off on the inside like he did poor Sean Porter, who's strong as a bull himself. Again, that I really want to see that fight. I was upset that the sanction that the IBF pushed Spence down to number two contender, because I want that fight, Brooks Spence, ASAP, soon as possible.
I agree.
I don't care if it's in England. I don't care if it's the United States. I just want to see that fight.
Well, right. You're probably going to get that fight anyway, Michael. You're going to get the fight anyway because I disagree with Gale. I don't think he's going to fight the winner of Ortiz Berto too. I think Danny Garcia has already dibs on that because he needs Asalka, and that fits Asalka on top between those two. But I think one thing that wants to do when you look at Spence, like I said, it's a little bit different than the fight with Brooke, is with Porter, the main thing that Brooke was able to do was just negate Porter's ability to headhunt at times, and Spence is not going to do that. Spence is actually going to invest in the body. At the same time, it's true, Spence hasn't taken a shot from somebody that is as strong as Kell Brook. So that's probably what is going to happen, because, let's face it, Danny Garcia is probably going to get the Ortiz Berto 2 winner. Though most likely Top Rank's probably going to make Bradley Vargas for the IBF, for that WBO belt, which kind of does leave the winner of Thurman Porter without a dance partner, really. Unless Khan really gets destroyed by Canelo and he goes back down to welterweight.
You mean win?
I don't mean win, I mean destroyed.
I mean, he said if he gets destroyed. I'm just throwing a joke in there. I'm saying,
yeah, just when he gets destroyed. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's pretty much what the picture is right now. I understand why not IBF did it, because they're within 2 weeks of each other. It was the Brook fight and the Spence fight. So I understand why they did it.
I don't get the whole thing, though, having a vacant spot, though. Like, why, just move everybody up one. To me, that makes no sense.
Right.
I think a lot of times, particularly with the IBF, what they try to do is they really want to see which one of their top two guys is the legitimate number one contender, because we've seen some ratings that are suspicious at best. So it's a way to even it out. And it could potentially yield big fights. Look at what's going to happen in the heavyweight division. We're going to have in 7 months Anthony Joshua either have to face Carlos Takam or Joseph Parker.
Yeah, I mean, that's my only critique with IBF is that, yeah, they follow their rules, which is one thing I love about them, but their rankings, like, to me, some of the people that are on their rankings leave something to be desired.
Well, let's look at the rankings right now, actually, because we just talked about this. Like I said, Spence right now is number two. The guy who he's not been ordered to fight, like I said, Konstantin Ponomarev, is number three. And number four is Lamont Peterson, who hasn't fought since how long?
Yeah, no kidding. What a joke.
I want to move on right quick and kind of combine two fights into one here. Talk about, and I'll just open it up for everybody in the hangout, talk about the Glowacki win. It was Steve Cunningham. Talk about the Marcus Browne win, quote, unquote, which I didn't think he deserved over Galagic. Excuse me if I'm pronouncing his name wrong. To me, you know, solid win for Glowacki. I think the difference was the knockdown. And again, the Marcus Browne, that supposed win, to me, he was outworked. He was out-hustled. He got hurt. He got put down, as far as I'm concerned. He didn't look good at all. He really got a decision here that he didn't deserve. especially after watching it the second, third time. I thought it was close the first time. The second and third time I watched it, my scorecards widened in favor of Hot Rod. Just talk about those fights, and I'll just open up for anybody here.
Yeah, the Browne fight is what makes casual fans dislike boxing. Because even a casual fan can look at that fight and say, he got robbed. Nobody needs to be an expert to see that. You know, how in the world the judges managed to prop that up on the scorecards, they just must have had a tutorial by CJ Ross. I don't know. It was horrible. And that's what kills me about a fight like that. You know, in the long-term scheme of things, except for the guy who lost, yeah, does it, you know, alter the course of boxing history? No. But it does turn guys off and women who are watching, you know, on free TV on NBC. You know, this is what they offer up, and this is what they think boxing is. And that's why a fight like that just kills me. Really, really makes me angry. Glowacki made a good impression after being off quite a while. Very solid fight for him. I like him a lot. I like what he's got to offer, especially in that division. But I really wish it had been against somebody else other than Steve Cunningham, who, as we were saying last week, you know, you can't help but like the guy. You pull for him. He's a great story. He's a stand-up human being. But that needs to be his last fight. That, he's done. The good news is he's got a lot of other things going on for him outside the ring. And, hey, I hope his art career and his, you know, comic writing career takes off. I really do. He's got some real talent. But he is going to have a long, happy life after boxing, and it needs to start now.
Jacob Daniel?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know anybody that scored, didn't score that fight for Hot Rod. So, I mean, Browne, that's an empty victory. And hopefully he doesn't boast about it because he did not win that fight. As far as Glowacki and Cunningham, I mean, I picked Glowacki to win by decision. The knockdowns were the difference in the fight. Steve Cunningham didn't do bad. I mean, he was. I like what I saw. I like him at the cruiserweight level. I agree. I mean, I would like him to call it a day. I just think his situation with his daughter, and you know, it's very rare that a boxer will walk away from the sport. I think we'll probably see him back in the ring again. Hopefully, you know, he doesn't get hurt or it doesn't go too long, but, you know, we know what the sport, that pull that the sport has, and, you know, he's in a tough situation, and I talked about it before, and Daniel shows that, you know, I would do anything for my kids, so, I mean, if that means I got to go get my head beat in for, you know, a couple grand, then I would go and do that. So, I mean, that's the tough situation that he's in. And I can't really fault him for it, but he is a. Hopefully, that other stuff you talked about, Gail, takes off. You know, I like him. I think he's a good dude. And, you know, but, you know, what can you say? Glowacki came in, he did what he had to do. You know, he showed that toughness and tenacity that I saw in the fight previous. And so, you know, hopefully we see some better matchups with the. Glowacki here in the near future.
I'll go to you, Daniel. There's a unification bout, I believe, on the undercard of Wilder Povetkin. Any chance that we will see Glowacki fight the winner?
There's a very, very high chance. Because the PBC will... This is one of the areas where the PBC will likely spend money on. Because you already know they're going to get a decent fight in Russia thanks to that Divian undercard of Wilder Povetkin. I can see it very, very high. Because the cruiserweight division is one of the, I like to, pretty much a forgotten division in boxing. Not a lot of people know about it. So it's easy then for them to make unification fights because imaging really doesn't play much of a factor into making these fights. You're in a division that a lot of people ignore. So there's not so much allure or business losses that you can take from losing a unification fight in a division like that. That could change, but we have to see. As far as these two fights, I'm just going to say like this from Marcus Brown. I'm just going to pretend that fight didn't happen. And in my mind, luckily, I didn't watch enough of it. I was actually enjoying the Atlanta Hawks versus the Boston Celtics at that time. So I'm going to leave it at that as far as Marcus Brown. With the Glowacki and Steve Cunningham, I'm in agreement with both Jake and Gale. It's time for him to walk away. He unfortunately spent too much time at heavyweight, which probably cost him a lot in his legs. So even though he's now in his natural weight class at cruiserweight, he doesn't have the same legs as before. And that division actually has some youngsters. So I don't think it's a good look, but it is true, the allure of the money in boxing can draw him back. Even though I think the purse wasn't that much. I think he only got, for this fight, I think $150,000.
I thought he got like two something. No, maybe not.
No, wait a minute. No, that was actually Algieri, I think. Algieri's the one that got like $200K from it, but
I thought Algieri got $300K while Spence got two something, two and change.
I may be wrong, like I said, but it's not the money that you typically saw like last year with PBC fights. It's a dramatic drop down. That's why I'm hoping like some of the things that Gail mentioned, like the comic book writing, the artistry really takes off. Hell, he could really, really help guide, as a Navy man, that boxing program that they have in Annapolis for naval officers.
Because
as an enlisted man, I'll say it like this. I have very low opinions of naval officers. Very, very low opinions of naval officers. I'll put it like this. You can have a degree in basket weaving and be an officer in the armed forces.
Oh, man.
You're cracking me up. But I'm sure you have ultimate respect for the fact that every single cadet at West Point goes through boxing. Every single cadet. He'd be perfect for that program. You're right on target there. Wouldn't that be great?
Cunningham made 225.
225, yeah, that's what I mean.
225, so did Spence. Algieri made 325, and Glowacki made 150.
I knew one of those two got really, really the low end of the stick.
Yeah, Glowacki got robbed. Damn.
Yeah, but that's a really...
I'm glad that Cunningham got his 225, though, because of his situation. And he's a good dude. I mean, he's put in his time, so...
Oh, yeah. And I'd like to see PBC, they're rotating their guys in and out as commentators. Put them on the broadcast crew and let them earn a few thousand bucks for a night of work. I'd enjoy hearing from him.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh. And I mentioned the Cruiserweight Unification on the undercard of Wilder Povetkin, and it's actually Dennis Lebedev, I think who's the WBA champ at Cruiserweight. He's going to be fighting unification bout against Victor Ramirez. Again, that's going to be an undercard of Wilder and Povetkin on the 21st of May, next month, a month from today, actually.
Yep.
Hopefully he can get a unification bout there and get some money, hopefully more than the $150K he got for fighting Steve Cunningham. Let's move on, and this was PBC happening basically the same night as a Showtime card in Manchester, Connecticut. Main event of that Connecticut card, Gary Russell Jr., a year layoff from his title win over Johnny Gonzalez, turned against the ring against Patrick Hyland. Yeah, we all knew that Hyland wasn't really up to snuff in comparison to Russell, but yeah, at the same time, Russell, he really did what he had to do. Just like Spence blew out Algieri, Gary Russell Jr. really blew out Hyland in an emphatic fashion. Letting folks know that basically I'm back, I'm here, and I'm coming out, and you know, all you featherweights, keep an eye out on me because I'm coming for you. Took Highland out in two rounds. Mismatch, yeah, but again, Gary Russell Jr., be that as it may, look damn good. I'll go see you on this one, Daniel. Your thoughts?
Now, the only question I have, and Jacob can agree with me on this, I think. If Gary Russell Jr.'s hand troubles are a thing of the past, then this is emphatic. Because he did exactly what he's supposed to do. He showed off the hand speed. He immediately made it evident that Patrick Highland was nowhere near his league. And the knockout was brutal enough where if you watch right afterwards, the Showtime cameras stuck a long time around him, and you could listen to the doctors talking and ask him, where are you at? Where are you at? And Highland was saying, after a while, it's like, New York, they spent a lot of time focusing on that. And that tells you the type of power that Gary Russell Jr. has, because I think prior to that, I don't think Highland was actually knocked down before.
No, he's never been down before.
Yeah, and Gary Russell Jr. did it three times in two rounds. So that's emphatic, and that's what I mean. If his hand troubles are a thing in the past, yeah, he's a problem in the featherweight division. And luckily, it's a division that, thanks to Al Haymon, he can easily make unification fights for. He can even make a unification fight in reality with Top Rank if, I think we're going to talk about it later on, if the position with Vasily Lomachenko shapes up the way it's looking, he could easily get into a fight with somebody with probably Oscar Valdez, and that, I don't care. If it's on the East Coast, I'm going to that fight. I am going to that fight. Because that would be a nice thing, because as polished as Valdez was, we've seen in that undercard, I don't think we've seen anybody with that hand speed of Gary Russell Jr.
Yeah, and indeed, I go to you on this one, Gail. Is there a faster? Is there a fighter in the world with faster hands than Gary Russell Jr. right now?
Boy, he's right up there for sure. You know, Pacquiao at his prime, of course. You know, let's see what Amir Khan does at a higher weight. You know, we've always been impressed with Amir Khan's hand speed. We saw some impressive hand speed, believe it or not, out of the Toe-to-Toe Tuesday event here a couple nights ago, which if we get into that, we can talk about. But it was very impressive. And, you know, Russell Jr. has really flown under the radar. You know, he has been a forgotten talent, and he put himself back into the conversation Saturday. And that is absolutely what he needed to do. You know, when's the last time we talked about him? I can't remember. Not on this show.
When we talk about Lomachenko. That's
yeah.
The only time yeah, he gets brought
up. That's
about
it. That's about it. So, you know, that offers something in a fight with Lomachenko, you know, for that rematch that's going to be very, very interesting. He's learned his lessons well. You know, and it isn't often that in a rematch, you can easily see it going the other way. You can now see it easily going the other way. It's going to be very exciting.
And well,
I
Michael,
love the
ask.
Fact. I love the fact that Russell is driven by revenge for this. I love it.
Oh, absolutely. Now, Mike, I got to ask you a question now because, like I said, this went up a couple weeks ago. Is Gary Russell Jr. now no longer the weak link at featherweight?
I said some would argue that he was a weak link. I didn't necessarily say that I believe that. Based on what we saw Saturday night, he would beat Selby. He would beat Carl Frampton. He could quite possibly beat Santa Cruz.
That's a fight I want to see.
Lomachenko. I would still go Lomachenko on the edge, but he will perform in a possible rematch. He will certainly perform better than he did in that first fight. That's for sure.
That's my issue with the first fight. I think the first fight, the hand issues were probably still in his head.
Well, he said he was, I don't understand this, but he said he was weak in that fight. He felt physically weak. For some reason, maybe he had weight issues and whatnot. But he said physically he just did not feel right for that fight. I just think personally that the moment got to him. First title bout, profile bout. I just think maybe the nerves and whatnot just got to him that night.
That very well will be the case.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the undercard of that bout. Look, I've been critical of Jose Pedraza, you know, mainly based on the Ed Nacheri bout, which I still felt he lost. But he fought Stephen Smith, went 12-round distance, unanimous decision win for Pedraza, 117-110 on one scorecard, 116-111 on two other scorecards. Look, you know, Pedraza, he looked very solid. Box Stephen Smith, fought in inside with him. Complete thorough performance, Jacob. You know, you can't knock him too much, based on the way he fought Saturday night. I'll tip my hat to him. He did the job.
Yeah, I mean, I thought he would win the fight. I thought it'd be a decision. Again, I still don't think there's a whole lot of upside for him, but I have to give him credit. He looked good on Saturday, and you know he did do the job, and so I got to give him credit there. You know, he impressed me more than I thought he would. I thought it would just go through the motions. And kind of like in a parallel, we'll say, timeline here, you know, Verdejo was fighting in Puerto Rico, and he had almost the exact opposite thing. He should have looked really impressive, and he didn't. So, you know, these two fighters, I'm not high on Verdejo or Pedraza, but we could talk about that a little later. But, you know, I still think that he's going to lose eventually, you know, if he fights a top competition. But again, you know, hats off to him for the win. Solid win.
Gail, Daniel?
Yeah, he did what he needed to do. I think at the end of the night, after you, you know, turn off your TV, you're not really thinking much about Pedraza after you've seen Russell. So kind of faded back into the woodwork. But, you know, and that can be a problem with a guy that needs to make a statement. But he did what he needed to do.
Yeah, I could pretty much agree with that. Like, he did look a lot better than in the Cherry fight. He did his job. He knocked down Smiths, who, amazingly enough, traveled with almost his entire family. The Fighting Smiths were ringside.
Right. Yeah, wasn't that interesting? Yeah, they've all recently had fights, Callum and Liam have both just had fights, so, you know, they can come over to the U.S. and have a good time, and they're on vacation. They're not working, you know, they're not prepping for a fight.
Yep. Now, Pedraza, like I said, he did look a lot better than what he did against Cherry, which luckily is a plus. The only thing about it, unfortunately, is just that it wasn't enough where it would stand out against what Gary Russell Jr. did. He did fade a little bit into the background, and that started a little bit of a Twitter war that was very, very hilarious. And we'll probably get to that later on, but
Speak on it now. Speak on it
now.
Oh, man. Okay. Let's start off first with Carl Moretti. He's the one that started it. Carl Moretti of Top Rank tweeted out a picture of the graphic of Gary Russell Jr. versus Highland, and just noticed how small the Pedraza line was, which really was a lot smaller than you would think for a co-feature. And he pointed it out. He said, hey, looks like a Pedraza. Looks like your promoter is treating you well. Look how you could barely read your name. Well, that ired Mr. Lou DiBella. And Mr. Lou DiBella went on a little rant, said, first he mentioned Carmoretti, said, this is the same guy who I hired when he had when he was having tough times, only for him to stab me in the back and go to Top Rank. And then he said, stop fucking with my fighters. Focus on your own little empire. Get Verdejo a better opponent than what you have. Carmoretti answered back saying, see you at the deposition. Hashtag lawyer up, hashtag got nothing to hide.
Wow.
Oh, no, the best part is today. Lou DiBella apparently started a GoFundMe page because there was an article saying the reason why Verdejo is not getting good opponents is because the money isn't there. So he decided to start a GoFundMe page to get a good opponent for Felix Verdejo. All you got to say when it comes to Lou DiBella at that point is troll world.
That's a vindictive ass up right there. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, and here you have, you know, guys like Moretti and DiBella who, you know, are so shy. You know, yeah, they just couldn't help themselves. They'll just get into it just for the sport of it. It's highly entertaining to watch. Yeah, DiBella will mix it up with anybody. Any troll, any person wants to take him on. He has a bring it on attitude. And honestly, unless you really got your shit together, do not tangle with Lou because you're going to lose.
Your thoughts on all those jiggles?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know why we can't all just get along, but.
You have to admit, sometimes sitting on the sidelines and watching it, you know, when it's not getting to be personal or racial or, you know, it's sexist or anything, and it's just, you know, good, clean shit talking.
Yes, but sometimes this stuff does start to get personal, and, you know, I mean, at the end of the day, all this side stuff, I don't really pay too much attention to it. You know, I just want to see, you know, the good fights, and the sport is where it's at. All the little side things are probably one of the most frustrating things about the sport.
You're a good man. You rise above it. Me, I find it highly entertaining. Crude, go for it. Better have at it, guys. Love
it. I mean, I like a good shit talking, you know, as much as the next guy, but, you know, at the end of the day, you know, it's, you know, I'd rather see I'd rather see competitive bouts in the ring than see two guys jab it on Twitter or something like that. But it is entertainment.
As long as the insults are of a professional nature, I'm good with it.
Yeah.
They were in this case because.
And they were. Absolutely, they were. They were completely about boxing, and that's fine with me. I think that's completely within bounds. You know, you start anything about your wife this or, you know, your personal behavior or, you know, your mama or, you know, your this, your background. No, 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 no. We don't go there.
Yeah, you bitch. Go ahead.
No, I'm just going to say, I just wonder how much money that GoFundMe page is going to get.
Well, have we checked? Have we checked? Is it really up?
Actually, let me look it up right quick.
Look it up. There's your assignment. Look that up.
while you look that up, within your discussion here about that little tiff between those two dudes, you mentioned Felix Verdejo. I want to talk about his bout real quick against Jose Luis Rodriguez. Yeah, Verdejo won 99-91 on two scorecards, 98-92 on the second. Third scorecard, excuse me. I watched the fight, and, okay, Verdejo, he got the win. But I don't care what anybody says, he did not look impressive at all. He looked like an average fighter in there. He didn't look like this rising contender prospect who folks have a big future for. Rodriguez, he tried to make it a brawl. Where was the clean counterpunching for Verdejo? Where was the movement? Where was the really good jab? It was sloppy throughout. He got hit a little bit too much for my liking. He looks like in his last two fights here that he's regressing instead of progressing. These last two fights really validates all the concerns that so many folks have about him in his career, particularly given how folks are, The way people are looking at this as evidence, as folks saying, he's not the next Trinidad. He's not the next Colo. He's not the next rising Puerto Rican star. You can't argue it. You can't argue that complaint about Verdejo based on his last two fights, particularly this fight. Again, I wasn't impressed at all. Anybody want a response?
Yeah, he got hit way too much. And again, like I said earlier, Verdejo has never really seemed special to me. I've been waiting for him to to prove it. But I don't think his top rank is doing him any favors by putting him in these fights and just keeping him active, but not stepping up the competition. I think, he could be one of those fighters that fights to the level of his competition, which is a bad thing. I spoke about it before. I think, a lot of people are kind of with Puerto Rican fighters and their heritage and just, their history with boxing. When someone exits the stage left and you're waiting for the next big thing, sometimes people will grab on to whatever's out there, even if it isn't the next great thing. He did get an endorsement from Tito, so, that definitely helps. But, I was talking to Puerto Ricans on Twitter, and, a lot of them were pissed by this performance and actually really turned off by it, saying they felt, shamed and disgraced. So, I don't know. He could be skating a dangerous line of turning off his fans and them not, showing up for, his fights at the Madison Square Gardens.
Okay, got done. And sorry, guys. Oh, sorry, guys. The Bella just talked about starting a GoFundMe account for Verdejo. He hasn't actually used it yet.
Dang. Returning to the Verdejo discussion, absolutely. These last two fights have been not impressive. Very lackluster, disappointing effort. Sure, he won. Sure, the scorecards were lopsided. They were more lopsided in the last fight. He got 2 100-90 scorecards in the last fight. And in the post-fight interview after the Silva fight in late February at Madison Square Garden, he kind of shrugged it off as, he said in the most polite way, yeah, I know I got some shit to work on. I do. He was at least forthcoming about it, but from February 27th to April 16th is not a lot of time to work on the shit you need to work on. And, after seeing this last fight, it occurred to me, and he's got his other date here in June, that Verdejo, at his age, and we have to remind ourselves he's only 22 years old, he's going to turn 23 here in about a month, so he's very young. He's the kind of fighter that would probably benefit and learn from a loss at this point of his career. Might be the best thing that could ever happen to him. And I'm not quite sure. I'm not sure quite who is the right guy to dish it out to him. But, there are a lot of people who have a loss and really roar back.
I think he needs a change of trainers.
That could be it. That really could be
part of the mix that, some guys do well at young ages once they've got lots of rounds under them. And some guys, no matter how many rounds they get, They're just young. They're just, their age is working against them, not for them. And I'm kind of wondering if we've got him, you know, it's like he's just stalled at this point. So what's going to push him over? Is it getting into the ring with, you know, a veteran old banger, a Ray Beltran kind of fighter, or, you know, who knows what? I don't know. But he cannot continue to have fights like this, because I don't care what the scorecards say, the luster is coming off him fast.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, would they put him in there with the likes of a Beltran? At this point of his career, given how he looked recently.
But it would knock some, you know, I'm saying, there are guys that, honest to God, they need to have kind of some sense knocked into them in a professional sense, you know, to go really through a war and wake them the hell up.
Maybe. One last fight I want to talk about here. You was out there watching this fight. I have not seen the fight in its entirety, so I'm gonna leave it up to y'all. Soto-Karass, Kamegai, from everything I read, it lived up to the war that many anticipated, had the crowd on his feet. Again, I'll just leave it up for y'all and y'all can comment on it.
Well, I was ringside right behind the timer in the front row, and it is rare that a fight built up that much lives up to its expectations. This one did. Absolute war, fantastic fight, exciting. That's a very intimate little venue. I should have had earplugs on. I swear to God, it was that loud in there for the whole fight. And in the last round alone, Soto-Karass threw quite a bit over 100 punches. That's the kind of fight it was. And they fought to a draw. And nobody was disappointed with that. Everyone was good with it. They, honest to God, really did fight to a draw. So now, of course, we all want to see him back on the, you know, undercard of something like Salido Vargas. You know, that's too soon. But, you know, they've earned their shot to get in front of a bigger audience, and I think it'll happen.
Yeah, even the fighters themselves, you know, they turned to each other, and I think they, you know, raised each other's hands, and I mean,
they slapped hands. Soto-Karass raised his hands in the air and kind of did the old school, you know, dual slap. It was great. And what's really funny is Soto-Karass, the Belasco Theater where these fights take place in L.A. is an old school theater with a big overhanging open lobby. Probably 150 people could get in there standing in the lobby space as you walk in under the underhang before you get to the doors. So as I was leaving after having packed up from the media section, you know, most of the time, you know, we're sort of the last few folks to walk out. There was still a massive crowd in the lobby, massive. Well, part of the reason is Soto-Karass is out there whooping it up, taking selfies, hugging fans. He was loving it. It was great.
Wow. That's cool. That is really cool.
Yeah. Yes, it was.
And some of the other young guys were out there, too. There were three different fighters in the Golden Boy stable who made their debuts, all with knockouts in two rounds or less, including a kid from San Diego in my area, Gennaro Gomez, who looked great. And he was out there greeting fans. And one of the most poised, solid fighters I've met in a long time. His manners were impeccable. He's extremely polite, thoughtful. For his age, it was really remarkable. And he'll be one to watch here in the future. He is training in San Diego, but he has ties to the Robert Garcia team, so we'll see what happens there. But yeah, those guys are all out greeting fans and photos all around, and there are, to my knowledge, several photos of me being hugged by Soto-Karass, because he was hugging everybody. He was hugging everybody. He was loving it.
Jacob?
Yeah, it was. I saw the fight on a stream, and Yeah, it delivered. I mean, you know, their styles, it was an easy matchup to make in the sense that we knew neither one of them was going to back down, and they basically, it was a pretty even fight. I did have Kamegai up, you know, just barely. But again, I'm not mad at the draw, and would love to see it again. And, you know, hopefully they get paid for it too. I mean, because they did pack that place. Gail was doing her work and keeping us updated, and it was a fun fight. You know, it was, you know, for a casual or even, you know, a fight fan in general, I mean, it's exactly what you want. You know, two guys are going to leave it all in the ring, and they're not going to be pissed at the decision. You know, they know they both fought hard, and you know, they respect each other. You can see the respect there. That warrior spirit, and so, you know, again, hopefully they do it again in the near future. And then just to, I don't know, I don't remember if you said anything about this, Gail, but Shabransky, you know, he got his win, and you know, he's another guy to kind of look out for in the cruiserweight division.
Yeah, he's also a character, Shabransky, a Ukrainian. He was part of this Eastern European invasion, all adopting the Mexican style of fighting. Not only has he adopted that, he's adopted a very specific Mexican nickname. Daniel, I believe you're probably familiar with it.
Chico Bransky, something like that.
He calls himself Chingonsky. Chingonsky! Yeah. Okay, yeah. So for all you Mexicans out there, Chingon is a very specific Mexican slang term. Yep. And the polite version is badass. There's various more profane versions of that. So he calls himself the Great Chingonsky on the back of his robe. It's hilarious.
And he was he had an interview with I think it was Dougie and Steve Kim and whatnot there. And he was actually throwing out some Spanish and whatnot.
Yeah,
he threw out some I think Russian Spanish and something else.
Yeah. No, one of these guys, he's really picked up a lot of Spanish, and you know, he thinks this is great. He's, you know, adopted a whole thing. He wears his sombreros into the ring, and you know, he endears himself to the fans by embracing the culture, and especially in a venue like that. That's absolutely makes him really, really marketable. And you know, for every Marcus Browne fight that just irritates the hell out of us, you go to a venue like that. It's very, you know, with the people, street level stuff. Good competition. Guys on their way up. Guys on their way, you know, have kind of crested the top of the graph in their career. And it's, you know, there's less of their career in front of them than behind them. And it's just good fun. Everybody goes out happy. It's not a game changer. It's not high stakes. It's not big money. You know, it's good. It's good, clean banging away.
Oh, it is, Gail. Let's put it to you this way: how my experience was, because I caught this fight on Ring TV live.
Because
I didn't. Unfortunately, I don't have Estrella TV. But I heard the Estrella TV people were hilarious.
Yeah, it was funny. There at one side of the ring on my left, and the Ring TV crew, Beto Duran, Dougie Fisher, and Steve Kim are on my right. You know, and they both know that they're, you know, doing their things on opposite sides, and they all share resources and have a good time.
Yeah. Let's put it to you this way. There was no feel around rounds for this one. Usually have a feel at round when it comes to veterans. As soon as the bell rung, Soto-Karass hit Kamegai with a 1-2.
Yeah, exactly.
Immediately, I think I tweeted out, this fight, you can't score this fight. It's too beautiful.
Right.
By the second round, I already said, just make the rematch already and put it in StubHub.
Right.
Because it was nonstop. It was nonstop. It was literally a poor man's Gotti Ward. I think you can literally say that. It's a poor man's Gotti Ward.
Yeah. There was a little less carnage, thank God. Kamegai got cut very early. He got cut by a punch. over the right eye, right at the corner, you know, where there's just not a lot of meat there, right in the second round. And his cutman did an absolutely outstanding job getting that thing under control. And that was really the worst of it. Soto-Karass looked pretty damn good when I saw him, you know, probably 40 minutes after the fight at most, 30. He looked pretty damn good, surprisingly, for taking that many shots. But both guys were mixing up their punches a lot. There was a lot of body work in that fight. And, you know, as hard as that is to have to, you know, withstand that kind of assault, it just doesn't do the kind of lasting damage, you know, that we all worry about with these guys. You know, you recover from that stuff if you're in good shape a little bit better.
Yep. And these guys, yeah, were in perfect shape. This is the thing. They've been trying to make this fight, I think, for 2 years.
Yeah. Golden Boy's matchmaker said he's been on this forever.
Yep.
Trying to get this done.
Yep. And so they knew for months ahead of time that they were facing each other. So they were in the gym very, very early. And interestingly enough, Golden Boy pointed this out. HBO was willing to pay money for this fight.
Oh.
Yes. Yes, they were.
Yeah, but Golden Boy said, you know what? It's probably better for us to put it on Australia TV, to put it on Ring TV Live. It fits this format better than probably putting it on HBO Latino.
You know they're what also I, doing a. They're also doing that card, I think, before the Con Canelo, right? Like a free card.
Yes, yeah. They are. They're going to do a card on Friday night in a new outdoor pavilion at the T-Mobile Arena. It will be the first event at the outdoor pavilion Friday. They're just starting to announce the card. They've been adding fighters every time I turn around to get a release. Oh, one more fight. Oh, one more fight. It is free to fans. They are not charging money for tickets. It is a walk-up, come on in and fight the night before. I believe the venue is being called the Toshiba Plaza. So it was a smart thing for De La Hoya and his folks to turn down the offer, the short-term HBO offer, because now there's a little bit of a mystique about this fight, and they made an investment by drawing more people to Estrella TV and RingTV.com, you know, probably half their audience were people who've never checked either of them out before, who had to go looking for both of those broadcasts or stream to be able to see this. So now they know where to find it, and they'll be back again in the future. So it was a way for them to build some audience. It was a good, good decision.
Not to mention that there was actually a secondary market for this. People were scalping tickets to this fight. That's
how. All right. Now, that I did not know. That's very interesting. Huh. The highest price face value ticket in there, I think, is $125, I think. And the cheapest is the upstairs balcony that doesn't have a – there's some rooms upstairs that don't have – an actual good line of sight, so they put monitors up, and it's like $10, and the bar's open. So, you know, most of the tickets are in kind of the $35 to $80 price range. So, but they all went really fast. They only sell 1,200 seats, and probably a quarter of those are standing room downstairs. So, the place just gets jammed. It's crazy. The word is that De La Hoya is going to move some of these bigger LA Fight Club cards over to the Olympic Auditorium, which would be wonderful. Love to see that.
I want to pivot to a couple of news events. Fight News is breaking news right now. We've talked in the past of Vasil Lomachenko, who he may fight next. Rocky Martinez has been interesting that now that the fight with Walters has broken down. Well, Fight News is reported that there's going to be an announcement next Thursday for a bout between Lomachenko and Martinez on Puerto Rican Day weekend, June 11th at the theater at MSG. undercard is going to be Verdejo. I guess the opponent to be named. I'll go to you on this one, Daniel. Your thoughts on this? I know you kept an eye on this over the past few weeks.
This, it was a little bit expected after Walters pretty much priced himself out. There's a couple of things that may be surprising to a lot of people considering top ranked sex plans initially. First, it's no longer going to be in the big room, Madison Square Garden. This is going to be in the theater once again.
Yeah, the little garden.
Yeah. So that one's going to, that's pretty interesting. And that's probably telling to something that Jacob mentioned when it came to the Verdejo fight, how, yeah, Puerto Ricans are pretty impatient when it comes to their fighters looking good. And maybe Top Rank saw that maybe, hey, there's a lot of Boricuas that are pretty pissed off at what we're doing with Verdejo here. Maybe not the big room yet, but still put it in the little room, in the theater, and still show them off in the fight. What's going to be interesting, though, is what Martinez's mandatory Burchard is going to do for this fight, because he's already threatened legal action. Because the backstory to this was Martinez was going to fight his mandatory because the Salido fight fell through. But he got hurt the week before the fight. So now that this fight's Lomachenko is going to be announced, Burchard's trying to say, no, you owe me a mandatory shot. And it might be a case where Martinez and Lomachenko will fight, but they're not going to fight for the WBO title at 130. Which is kind of pointless considering that Lomachenko has this goal of every single one of his fights being a title fight. And if that happens, you can't ask Rocky Martinez to go down to featherweight. So that's going to be an interesting thing to look into, because as expected as it was after the Walters fight fell through, there's a couple of bumps in the road still.
Jacob Gale.
I mean, again, I wanted to see that Walters fight. The guy priced himself out, which I think is a mistake. But, you know, Martinez isn't a bad replacement on this short of notice. I don't think he's going to win. But, I mean, again, if you're trying to build off the momentum of that weekend, just the excitement around that Puerto Rican day weekend, you know, this is a smart move to have another fighter of that heritage there. And, you know, Rocky Martinez will give, a good showing, but I just think Lomachenko's is the goods, and he'll outclass him. And then hopefully Verdejo, you know, hopefully he gets his act together, man, and, you know, doesn't have a bad showing. Because, again, I think like Daniel mentioned, you know, the fans can be unforgiving. You know, if you don't show up and don't endear yourself to them, then, you know, they hang on to that for a long time.
I just can't help but think Walters is pricing himself out knowing he's going to get shut out, because his last performance, you know, was not all that. I mean, it was Verdejo-like. And what fans don't like, you know, they understand a guy getting beat fair and square. What they don't like is seeing guys hyped up who then don't live up to the hype, who don't perform up to the promises. You know, it's all about setting expectations. And, you know, I mean, Walters, in his case, did set his own expectations with that spectacular performance against Nonito Donaire. I mean, he just blew out of the gate. But then he fights, you know, to what should have been a loss, gets a draw. Verdejo just not showing any sort of improvement. You know, this is a problem. So, you know, given what there was to work with, I think Top Rank made the best of the situation they could. Rocky Martinez has certainly earned these opportunities as a fighter. But, I mean, he lost to Orlando Salido. He's not going to lose, or he's not going to beat Lomachenko. It's just, it's not going to happen. But it gives a certain fan base somebody to root for, and I don't dislike him having the opportunity. I am setting my expectations accordingly.
Here's the thing with Walters, though. And this is something that Gail, you probably appreciate because you're looking at it really, really nice from Vince's perspective. It may not be really him pricing himself out. It's probably his co-promoter, Warriors Boxing, who...
Right. Well, right.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's the thing. And they just recently, I think, had a falling out with the PBC and Al Haymon, because they're based mainly in the Midwest, mainly in Chicago. And every time I ask Joe and Francis when they're on the show about it, and they say there's a lot of fighters in Warriors Boxing that were getting fights because of the PBC, then they've been sitting on the shelf for months.
Oh.
Okay.
For months. So now they're trying to get the big money. So I understand that's more the motivation coming in. And like I said, interestingly enough, Top Rank went from a situation where they may be dealing with somebody impacted by Al Haymon to somebody that is signed to Al Haymon. So they're still dealing with the same monster when it comes to this. The main gripe probably I have about when it comes to Walters is, and I partly blame the WBA for this, we were robbed of the Uchiyama fight this year.
Yes, yeah.
Right. Yes, good point.
Uh-huh. So this was the best alternative to fight Lomachenko, because that's the bad part about Walter, that he knocked out Donaire with such ferocity that you hope that carried on. And yeah, that last performance wasn't good, but it's also it could also probably be a case of his power not carrying enough from featherweight. Maybe he really does need to go back down to 126 to show that knockout power.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, we're not going to know if he doesn't step into the ring.
Well, do you think he can get down there for 126?
If he doesn't spend all his time in Jamaica.
What you saying, man?
Natty Turner talked about how, yeah, he got down there and celebrated a little bit too long when he was in Jamaica, eating that good food and put on a little bit of excessive weight. So that very well could be his case. And Walters has said when they tried to make the fight with Lomachenko the first time that I can make the weight, I just need time and I basically need to stay active. Just give me an opportunity to do so.
And unfortunately, that's not the case. And I just really hope that Nicholas Walters doesn't wind up in another Mikey Garcia situation for Top Rank. Where, in this case, like I said, at least Walters is co-promoted by somebody, but it's co-promoted for somebody that needs money right now.
But the difference is that Mikey Garcia, at the end of the day, that was on him. That was on him. He chose to say split ways with Aram and got tied up. With Walters, I don't think that's the case. And let's face it, when you look at this Lomachenko back, as you stated before, basically this was a fallback fight with Lomachenko. He was initially going to fight Uchiyama. And again, if it wasn't for the WBA, that fight was going to happen, I believe. With Uchiyama coming to the States to make that fight happen. So he's been a bit of bad luck situation. So
That's the fight I'm really mad about. The fight that we lost, that one Uchiyama, because if people have not seen Uchiyama, you better YouTube him right now and watch some of his fights. That's what we missed out on because the WBA had a little bit of a tournament. And interestingly enough, the guy that Uchiyama was supposed to fight was another fallback guy for Lomachenko. Don't remember, like, last week, apparently Lomachenko's manager said that, oh, we signed a contract with Javier Fortuna. And I said it before that I think it was just a way to get Rocky Martinez back on the negotiating table. It worked. But we lost out in a really, really good fight between Walters and Uchiyama because of it. Maybe they'll make it up this year because Uchiyama's people are really, really hell-bent because they know time is not their friend right now. They know they need to make a splash in the U.S., and they have to make it soon. And with other Japanese fighters like the Kameda brothers, we just talked about Kamegai, Yoshihiro Arakawa. And interesting enough, I know I'm going to delve into, unfortunately, sports entertainment, but even some of the people that apparently the WWE have been signing from Japan, I've been coming in looking at good. Like, I think there's a guy named Shinsuke Nakamura that fights like MMA, but in the wrestling ring. And there's a girl, I think she goes in Japan by the name of Kana, that apparently is the best female professional wrestler in about a decade from there. So they have that backdrop coming in. And to miss out on that against somebody like Nicholas Walters, who you know is gonna bring a crowd, it's really, really bad because, unfortunately, like I said, Uchiyama, time is not on his side.
Yeah, because he is 35.
Mm-hmm.
35, so if he wants to get a big fight, it's time for him to make the move now. It really is. I want to move on a little bit of news quickly before we break down the fights coming up this weekend. Anthony Joshua announced that he's going to be back in the ring June 25th, defending his IBF heavyweight title for the first time. There's talk about maybe Stavern, the guy who beat Adamek. His name escapes me right now. Could you help me out, people? Eric Molina. And another guy, a third opponent whose name escapes me right now. I'll go to you, Jacob, since it's been a while since we heard from you. Thoughts on the fact that Joshua is returning to the ring so soon? I personally think it's a good move for him because he's still developing. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I don't mind when the guys get back in the ring soon because when it comes down to it, he didn't really take any damage in that fight with Martin. So, I mean, you know, you train, you prep for a tough 12-round fight, or hopefully that's what he's doing. And, you know, he blanked the guy in two rounds. So, I mean, he's ready to go. So, you know, get him back in there. And I don't have a problem with that. As far as the opponents, I don't really care to see the Stavern match. I think Stavern, I don't know if Wilder took something out of him or what, but he hasn't looked good. He didn't look good in his last fight. I don't know that fight's going to be too competitive. The Molina fight has a little bit of intrigue, so I wouldn't mind seeing that one. Definitely more than the Stavern fight. And what was the third guy? Hello?
Dominic Brazil.
Yeah, Dominic.
Oh, I can't stand that guy.
Yeah,
so, I don't want him to get the fight at all. The only way I'd want him to get the fight is just to see him get knocked out.
Yeah, Joshua didn't even need a shower after the fight with Martin. I mean, he didn't even work that hard, so no problem him getting right back in. And it is so smart, A, for him to capitalize on the attention, and B, to knock somebody out of the way so there's less objection when some of the bigger names are ready. He can say, hey, already took care of him. I'm ready for you, Tyson Fury, or whoever else it is in front of him.
Yeah, Molina would bring a really good, I think, measuring stick in the sense of depending on how he takes out Molina, if he does. Because it was an opponent of Wilder, and I think that fight went 10 rounds. So,
right.
Even though Wilder dominated,
Same with Stavern. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, the Wilder, I mean, the Molina tells me more, I think, in a sense, because of the way he has looked after the Wilder loss versus Stavern, who hasn't looked good at all.
True. Although, you know, it's the tough call because Stavern would bring a bigger audience because he's a bigger name and therefore more money.
Yeah, but I mean, Anthony Joshua's not doing bad for himself in the UK. I mean, he's kind of like a Canelo in the sense that he can fill an arena on his name alone.
Right, but his ambitions are bigger. I mean, this sounds really funny that I'm going to hear myself saying this. Joshua's ambitions are bigger than filling Wembley Stadium. He wants to fill every single venue around the world he can possibly get into. So he does
become more familiar with
the American audience. So, you've got Stavern, who is very well known in North America in general. So it's a good call for him to bring that name in there. Molina doesn't quite carry, other than among us hardcore, you know, he isn't bringing the audience broadening base that Joshua is looking for. I mean, this is a really good time for him to invest in some of those new, you know, some of those new demographics. He wants to find all of those people and introduce himself in a very impressive way so that when he's ready for the big game, everybody knows who he is.
Daniel.
All right, Gal, convinced me.
Okay. Daniel, when you first heard it, when I was telling you this before the show, your first thought was, it looks like this opens up an opportunity for HBO to televise the bout. Explain what you meant by that. Are you thinking that because it's not going to be on July 9th, the same day as Fury Klitschko 2, that HBO could try to get their way in and air this fight?
Yep, that's pretty much the mindset, because if Joshua picked July 9th, then HBO had to make a choice. Either honor the contract that you have with Vladimir Klitschko, which I think he has still one. This is probably the last fight in the HBO contract. Or pay more for Joshua. And this opens up the avenue where they can actually pay for Joshua and still fulfill the contract obligation to Fury. No, it's not to Fury, to Klitschko. Here's the situation when it comes to this particular instance, naming the three opponents. And Gail mentioned, I said that this is probably just preparation for Joshua to get to the much bigger money coming in. If you're looking for a name, you're definitely out of those three, you're going to go with Stavern. Because at least you can say former world champion Stavern facing new champion Anthony Joshua. And not to mention, there's probably a pretty decent, thanks to how diverse the Haitian community is when it comes to immigrating, there's probably a pretty decent Haitian crowd in England. So it would not surprise me to do there. The other two, Eric Molina, wouldn't mention, it's a pretty decent measuring stick considering how he did Adamic. And it's something that it's feasible. I don't want to see Dominic Brazil. No.
He doesn't deserve it.
No, he doesn't deserve it. I know, like I said, I think I mentioned it before we got on air. I heard the possibility of the matchup actually on the hangout with Boxing Beats and Rhymes. Somebody suggested it because it would just be saying two Olympians fighting together, but Dominic Brazil does not deserve that shot. But that's pretty telling of how Hearn wants to position Joshua. He does not want to give him any essentially tough challenge with his, right now, his lone voluntary shot, because along with ruling that Spence has to face somebody to get the number one contender spot, they also announced that Anthony Joshua has to face the winner of Joseph Parker versus Carlos Takam in within 7 months. Within 7 to 9 months. And the only way, and we know the IBF, the only thing that they make exceptions for are title unifications. So Anthony Joshua is going to have to face either Joseph Parker or Carlos Takam after this, unless he decides really to go into the lion's den with either Deontay Wilder or Tyson Fury. And the thing I want to ask you when it comes to this, Gail, how long do you think until Joshua should come to American Shores? Because unfortunately his criminal record is probably the main thing that's keeping him out.
Right. Well, you know, there needs to be some, now that we see his potential being realized, I would expect that Mr. Hearn will cough up some money for some smart American attorneys to look into, you know, what sort of rules can be bent, what sort of things can be done, how do you go about going back in somebody's record and addressing these issues. You know, there's a lot of wiggle room in the law as long as you've got smart lawyers working for you, and they will earn every bit of their pay. It's something they need to look at right now. That's another reason, though, why you look at guys who are in areas adjacent. You know, I don't know whether he's going to face those restrictions. For example, if he went to make a fight in Montreal, in Canada, and there's where you have Bermaine Stiverne. They have a fight there. You know, that's going to draw a massive crowd, massive, if they do that. So that's something they might need to look into and see. You know, as a you know, former nation under British rule and a Commonwealth country, it may not be an issue.
But they're having to fight at the O2 Arena, though.
Right. I'd say, well, in this case, but in the future, you know, when they want to bring him over here for a fight, let's say he fights Molina in the O2 Arena, and then they want to get him over here, but because of the legal issues they've got, they've got constraints they can't get around, that's when I think you'll look to making a fight in Montreal, if that was me. And, you know, plenty of hardcore fans from the northeastern United States are going to have no problem getting into Montreal for that fight.
That's an interesting angle. Very interesting angle. Thinking about it now, I wouldn't be mad at that. Get it in a pretty sizable place. Because you know the UK crowd is going to show up. They're so excited about him.
Yeah.
And as you said before, folks from here in the States, they will head up to Canada, make a big promotion of it. Actually, yes, I could see that. I don't know who that would be against. Probably the mandatory, I'm not sure. But yeah, I could see that possibility.
You take Bermaine Stiverne up there.
Oh, okay, Stiverne, okay.
Yeah, absolutely. He's got a, you know, he's got a fan base there. They've got, you know, such a huge Haitian enclave up in Montreal.
Yeah, you're right. You know? Because he's been there for fights with Pascal and Stevenson. So he has a bit of a following there.
Yeah, well, you've got a really big Haitian expatriate community in Montreal because they speak French. So,
right.
As cold as it is, you wouldn't think Haitians would, you know, have all flocked to Montreal, but they did. So, and you know what? It wouldn't even matter because Canadian fight fans are great. And they fill those joints. They don't care who's fighting. They show up. They put butts in the seats. And that's exactly what they want to do with Joshua.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Let's move on. Talk about the fights that's happening this weekend. I want to, since we're a little bit pressed for time, I want to combine this HBO doubleheader into one and just go around the hangout here. Gennady Golovkin defending his middleweight title against Dominic Wade on the undercard, or co-main, a co-feature here, if you will. Ramon Gonzalez fighting McWilliams Arroyo. I believe I'll start. And I know you was at the teleconference today, Gail, listening. Your thoughts on this bout, Golovkin Wade? Gonzalez, Arroyo. I don't see much happening for Wade. I think Arroyo's only chance here is to land with power shots. Your thoughts on both bouts?
I would say Arroyo has slightly more of a chance against Chocolatito than Wade does against Triple G. And that is not to slight Chocolatito. That is more of a slam against Dominic Wade. It's proportional. You know, I give the man credit. I give the man respect. He is willing to get in the ring. He is willing to put an undefeated record in there. That is being a man. That is being more of a man than a lot of other guys. Billy Joe Saunders. So,
well,
I tip my Canelo. Hat. Canelo.
Welp.
yeah. But just run down the list. And that was duly noted today at the news conference by several people, including Abel Sanchez, Triple G's trainer, said, listen, he got in the ring. He's going to get in the ring. He agreed to this fight when a lot of other guys wouldn't. You know, he's a man. We respect that. But if you've seen any of the interviews that Golovkin has done when he's been asked about, well, you know, what kind of fight is it going to be? It's not if you get a knockout, it's when. And is it going to be a Willie Monroe type fight, you know, where you let it go a little while, or are you going to go right after it? And he just grins. So, you know, he's just going to assassinate him, you know, because in this case, he's sort of damned if he does and damned if he doesn't. So this is one of those fights where there's everything in it for him to get a Marco Antonio Rubio style second round knockout and just make the fans go nuts. So I think you're going to see, at the very least, a first half of the fight knockout done. Chocolatito and Arroyo will probably be, from a performance standpoint, a more interesting fight to watch. Chocolatito is just so good. I think Arroyo will hang in there for a few rounds and, you know, eventually Chocolatito is just going to beat him down and it's going to be over. But the fans will love it. It is heading for a sellout at the Forum. There are well over 14,000 tickets sold. The capacity is a little over 16 to be considered a sellout. And if they edge towards 16,000 seats, that will be the biggest ticket sales in Southern California for a fight since the Forum was refurbished. And that also, if you start doing the math, means that Golovkin, between the last fight and this one in 6 months, has sold 37,000 tickets. That's pretty impressive.
Jacob, Daniel?
Yeah, I got Triple G by murder, death, kill in the third round.
Slaughter.
I really don't think, you know, with the Monroe fight, as much as people talk about, you know, he let it go on and stuff, I don't know if I believe that. I think that's a very kind of risky thing to do, but it's good. It's good for the cameras and it's a good story, but I think he's gonna totally outclass Wade. And, you know, I think Wade, we talked about it before, he's got a lot of other problems in his mind right now. I don't know how focused he is on this fight, but Triple G is a beast at that weight, and I think everybody knows it, so I think it'll be a short night for the crowd, but I don't think they'll be any less satisfied if it's a, you know, a highlight reel knockout. As far as the Chocolatito fight, I agree with Gail. I think this is the more competitive fight, and it's not a slight on Roman, but I you know, Arroyo's a tough guy. I think Chocolatito will steal the show and stop him in the fifth round. But you know, this is really a showcase card, and you know, the crowd's going to be hyped, and I don't think they're going to care either way as long as the right guys win. And you know, I think they're going to be, I saw on Twitter, I think it was, they'll be having the new Triple G shirts, you know, some new gold shirts or whatever, and I think he's coming in with the LA Rams colors, so he might set a record in, like he did in Madison Square Gardens with merchandising.
Yeah, he is. He is wearing the Rams colors. He's now worn the Dodger blue and white. He's worn the Lakers purple and gold. He's won the new. He's worn the New York Rangers, red, white, and blue, when he was in New York. Now he's wearing the Rams original colors. Anyway, I don't think they're going to change when they come back to L.A. out of St. Louis, are they? So, merchandise is all going to be new, and everything not nailed down is going to be bought. It's get out the credit cards, everybody. Go raid the ATMs.
Raid the ATMs indeed, because you can bet your bottom dollar that they're already going to have Jordan Brand Triple G gear at that fight.
Right, right, exactly. Yeah, which will be extremely nice. And I can say, having been at Madison Square Garden, watching people buy that stuff, I mean, it was like ants on honey. I mean, it was crazy. People were shoving each other out of the way to get up in line and get that stuff. You know, it was like throwing meat to hungry lions or something. So I think people will, and I think everything said is absolutely right. I think the crowd will be equally happy with a spectacular second round knockout as they would see in 8 or 9 good rounds.
Quickly, going back to this fight before we talk about a couple other fights, and Jacob reminded me of this earlier today. As a women's bout happening on this undercard, as
there are two women's bouts.
Sunicio Estrada is happening. And Kania Enriquez fighting Amiris Quintana, junior lightweight bout. Quickly talk about those bouts.
Go ahead.
I'm just excited to see women's boxing on the card. I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think not the Estrada bout, but the other bout is going to be shown on international TV. On the HBO feed or something like that. I think I read that somewhere. So I think it's a good step up for them to be able to get to, and I think there's only like 6 or 7 bouts on the card, but to get that many bouts on the card. The last time they were at the Forum, Estrada was on the card, and it was a damn good fight, and she impressed. And, you know, the crowd was really into it. So I hope this is an evolution in women's boxing. And hopefully, you know, paired with the Olympics coming up and whatnot, we start to see more of the women boxing get the respect they deserve.
Yeah, I'm very pleased. There has been a commitment by K2 to give women some opportunities on these cards, on the undercards. LA is the perfect place to do it because there is the Mexican-American fan base who really appreciates women's boxing. I mean, you know, of anywhere in the northern, you know, western hemisphere, North America, this is a place where they're really into it. And Estrada is a local gal. She's, you know, East LA, born and raised, still lives there, and very, very personable. They know her from having brought her on the last card, so she was a lock. And she was announced very, very early. The other fight with Enriquez and Quintana was announced a bit later. They're fighting at the women's light flyweight division. Estrada is at the super flyweight division. And those divisions in women's boxing are obviously a little different than the men's boxing. Super flyweight for the women is 115, I think, is the weight limit on super flyweight for the women. And then the light flyweight division, I think, is 108. So that's where they are. Enriquez is from Tijuana, still lives in Tijuana. She's 22, and she is 15-1. She's got 7 knockouts, which is for women fighters is a pretty high percentage. Estrada is 5-0 with a single knockout. But women simply get less fights than the men do. There's just less competition at the level, professional level for them. So when you see a woman with 5 fights, it doesn't translate the same way as it does with the male fighters. So you can almost double whatever they've got on their record and have it be more or less equivalent. So as Estrada is extremely charismatic, she's very personable, she knows how to do an interview, do the whole thing. And you're absolutely right, Jacob, to point out that they are thinking about leading up to the Olympics. Even NBC and HBO is positioning Clarissa Shields as being one of the stars of this Summer Olympics. If she doubles up her gold medals, she will be the first American boxer to do that in decades.
Oh my God! Yeah, I love the HBO Real Sports thing that they did. It was a fight game. I'm sorry, with Clarissa Shields, because it's not only the Olympics, but unfortunately the situation that her hometown from Michigan is going through right now with their water system.
Yeah, she's from.
She is from Flint, Michigan.
And we all know that situation was just maddening, to say the police. I'm gonna be polite, or that's because I'm already in a funky mood now. I'll just end up cussing folks out regarding that situation.
We do not blame you, Michael. Not at all. It highlights it. It highlights it in a way I don't think that maybe people are gonna do. And Clarissa Shields, second deal.
Well, and she has made it very clear she is fighting not just for herself, but for the people of her hometown, to give them something to root for. She really understands that she's a symbol of her community. She accepts that responsibility. She's embracing it. And it's been nothing but good for her. You know, she was only 17 when she was in the Olympics in London. And to see her maturity level now compared to being, you know, sort of that rough-edged 16, 17-year-old that she was the first go-around is astonishing. I'm so proud of her. I'm so impressed by her. You know, she is still just 21 years old, and she's carrying all those expectations and that responsibility with amazing grace and fortitude, and she's just so confident in her abilities. I absolutely love that. When you really scratch the surface and then get talking about the sport of boxing with her and, you know, her abilities in the ring, I mean, she has every bit the swag of a Muhammad Ali at that age. It's fantastic.
It is. And going back to the card in this event, like I said, smart marketing, Mexican-American audience to those guys. And this is going to help a lot, because one of the things that, to me, that really hurt women's boxing is the fact that up to now, up to 2012, they really didn't have a way for the amateurs to shine at the Olympics.
Yeah.
Can you imagine Clarissa Shields having been male? You know, she would have been the equivalent of an Errol Spence, but on steroids. I mean, somebody would have grabbed her in a minute, signed her, and she'd be the one getting, you know, the equivalent of the big fights right now. Instead, she was smart, though, to stay amateur. There was no reason for her to become a professional as a teenager. This is exactly the right route for her, because her money-making, her maximum money-making future is not really in the sport of boxing as a woman. It is in the other opportunities and doors it will open for her.
Oh, she's going to have endorsements like nobody's business.
I hope so, Michael, but damn it, she should have had them 4 years ago. She didn't get shit. It was very upsetting. And I know we're running long on time, but I am going to bring this up. Oscar De La Hoya recently wrote a opinion piece for the Los Angeles Times newspaper against having professionals fight in the Olympics in boxing. That's fine, and I agree with him. But in the course of the article, he made mention that no American has won a boxing gold medal.
Oh, no, he did.
2000, yes, he did. He went there. 2004. We haven't had a gold medal in boxing since 2004. And I thought, Oscar, man, really? So the paper heard from me. The writer heard, the editors heard from me. Oscar heard from me. I actually have not checked to see whether that did. So I figured, you know, I won't take a chance. And I wrote in the comments, there is an error in this story. Here is the error. And I pointed it out. So, you know, we'll see whether they actually, you know, had the cojones to fix that mistake. That is just so damned insulting. And that is what she's faced. But they will not be able to deny her if she wins a second gold medal. And I hate to say it, classic situation for anybody who's got to work twice as hard to get what they deserve. And that's the position she's in.
Indeed.
It's all that coca from Oscar, man. Brain cells.
Yeah, we can remember Andre Ward. You can't remember her? Please.
A couple more fights I want to quickly mention. Nonito Donaire fighting Zsolt Bedak in the Philippines. Carlos Cuadras is fighting as well against a Filipino fighter by the name of Mepranum. Cuadras' fight is about as somewhat significant because we could see him in against Chocolatito, should Chocolatito win. Donaire, this looks like an easy win. If it's in the Philippines, it probably is. Quickly, folks, your thoughts on these two bouts?
Like you just mentioned it, Mike. It's in the Philippines, so Donaire's going to win. that's all you need to know. If it's in the Philippines, Donaire's going to win. And Cuadras is going to be interesting because Chocolatito has pretty a tough decision to make. It's either going to be Cuadras, a rematch with Estrada, or, like I think Jacob, you mentioned before that Chocolatito looks a little bit heavy recently. He may have to go to 115, and it may be a little early, but Inoue is waiting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's
and everybody listening should mentally picture all of us rubbing our hands together in glee.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, let's look at the fact. Chocolatito, as much as the pairing of Triple G and Chocolatito work. Oh, by the way, I say Triple G beats Wade in four rounds. Chocolatito beats Arroyo in seven rounds. Even though those two guys have made a pretty decent tag team as far as drawing in, I think Chocolatito wants to headline his own show. This was supposed to be the time he was supposed to headline his own show. But it's the only way he's going to headline his own show right now is if he faces one of those three guys. Cuadras, a rematch with Estrada, or Inoue. That's probably the only option that HBO is willing to pay the money that Chocolatito and K2 are going to ask.
Quickly, Jacob.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have too much more to add. I mean, Donaire is going to probably win that fight. I did want to point out one thing, though, and we were talking about it earlier, and that Walters fight, I know, you know, Walters ended up beating him, but Donaire actually had Walters hurt in that second round badly. If there was an extra 15 seconds, I don't know, we could have had a different fight. Just wanted to point that out.
I think we're going to shut the show down on that note. I'm going to go around to hang out here and ask everybody to talk about what they do. Ladies first, Gail Falkenthal, Communities, Digital News. But folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
I am found on the website Communities Digital News, which is a general interest news website that thankfully gives us plenty of room to cover boxing. And it's at comdiginews.com. Comdiginews is also the Twitter handle, and you can find me there or at PR Pro San Diego or hanging out ringside.
Indeed. Jacob Rivera, for folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, let the folks know where to find.
Yeah, I can be found on Twitter at JRATM23. I try to stay as active as possible on Twitter. And I will be at the fights with Gail, and also the following weekend. Love seeing light fights. I love being in the atmosphere. So, and I love talking boxing. I have my website, jabhookboxing.com. And wanted to also say shout out to Michael for having the show. I know it was a rough day, but you know, we got through it with the passing of Prince, and I appreciate you having me on the show. And then also Daniel's show on Sunday, sometimes Monday. You know, follow them, like their shows, subscribe. And one last shout out, my top prospect of the year got Jason Quigley, Irish kid from Donegal. He got a fight with, I think it's De La Rosa, the guy that was supposed to fight Lemieux in Canada when he missed weight. That's going to be on the undercard of Con Canelo. So good job, Jason, and good luck.
Indeed, indeed. Daniel Carpio from the inside for folks who want to talk boxing. NBA, Miami Heat basketball. Let the folks know where I can hit you up.
All right. You can find me at Twitter at Raucus99. Like I said, I do write for the Inscriber Digital Magazine. Like I said, I do write some mainly boxing, and I also write basketball. Like I said, mainly the Miami Heat. Like my most two different pieces are recaps of the series with the Hornets so far. I want to give a shout-out to actually Peter Clark, who also does really good boxing work for the Inscriber as well. If I'm not at the fights, he's most likely there. And I want to give a special shout out to the people of Minneapolis, Minnesota, because if you are looking right now on Twitter, they are having a beautiful, beautiful block party in memory of Prince. They literally just had a block party, I think in the middle of like First Avenue, for the death of Prince, and another shout out to a good Minnesotan, Patrick Fenelon. Wow.
Yeah, earlier, of course, it's been raining, not purple, but it has been raining most of the day in Minneapolis. Thankfully, not too hard to keep people out of the streets. And just before sunset, there was a huge rainbow over Paisley Park, caught by a lot of the news media there. Absolutely. As it should be. It just seemed so right. And Jacob, I'm so glad you mentioned that. Thank you, Michael, for carrying on. It has been a really rough year, and it seems like it's always hit us on Thursday, but, you know, we're still kicking.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. For folks who want to talk boxing or anything else, you know what it is. Brother JR, Twitter at Brother JR76. If you want to find more information about Half Pound Boxing Report, just go to the blog page, p4pboxingreport.wordpress.com. You look to the right of the blog page, you can find links to find us all over social media, all over the interwebs. Links to find us on Facebook, G+, Twitter, YouTube, Tumblr. We got a Pinterest board, the link for the RSS feed, the link to find us on Stitcher Radio, Flipboard Magazine, SoundCloud, iTunes, the email address, p4pboxingrpt@gmail.com. And as of Monday, as of this week, you can now find the Half Pound Boxing Report on Google Play Music. I just got the email from them earlier this week. You can find the Half Pound Boxing Report, the past episodes there on Google Play Music, so check us out there. On the next episode of Half Pound Boxing Report, we will do a recap of the doubleheader on HBO, Triple G, Dominic Wade, Chocolatito, McWilliams, Arroyo. We'll do a recap of the Donaire fight with Bedak, the Carlo Cuadras bout, and we will do a preview of the doubleheader on Showtime, Super Middleweight doubleheader, Badu Jack fighting Lucien Boutte, James DeGale fighting Porky Medina now. We may, I doubt it, but we may talk Ortiz-Berto rematch. We may. So we'll talk about...
we may or may not be there.
Yeah.
You know, they're doing
it. I want to be there.
Well, yeah, they're doing a big fan fest, bringing in a bunch of fighters and setting up bars a few hours before the first card, and so everyone can get good and liquored up before Berto Ortiz.
So, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Like I say, May. Emphasis on May. Talk about that. For Gail Falkenthal, for Jacob Rivera, for Daniel Carpio, I'm your host, Michael. This has been another episode of Pound for Pound Boxer Report. We talked about Prince the first 20 minutes or so of the show, and I want to say again, condolences to the family. Condolences to friends. And condolences to all the other Prince lovers out there. Again, we talked about doing the show. We did the show with a bit of a heavy heart. But again, rest in power, Prince Rogers Nelson. This has been another episode of the Box Report. We will see you next. We will see you some. We'll see you in the future. Everybody, have a good evening. Good night.
Peace.
Good night.
R.I.P. Prince.
That's right. Play that.